Шановні колеги, шановні.
Dear colleagues, the Ukraine Crisis Media Center continues its work. The topic of briefing is Ukraine and Europe, challenges of populism and prospects of cooperation. Our speaker today is Sybe, Dutch politician, Liberal Party MP, and also philosopher, intellectual, and the author of many books, six of which were translated into Ukrainian. So now I give the floor to Sybe. Welcome.
Yeah, добрий день. Well, for me to be here, yeah, shall I? It's a special week for me as a senator. It's between the two Tuesdays in the Netherlands that I was here. Last week Tuesday we had the debate in the Senate about the European-Ukraine treaty. And tomorrow, at Tuesday again, we will vote about that treaty. Well, the good news is we had an interesting debate. It's only the populists, you know, that didn't behave too very well, but you know about that. And tomorrow we will have the voting, and well, it will be sure, you know, that there will be a wide majority pro-treaty. And that will end a period that I feel ashamed about, and you allow me to say that. You know, all the countries of the European Union were in favor of this treaty, and your country, well, you did a lot of it, you know, to bring it so far. And then we had that ridiculous law on the referendum in the Netherlands, and populist groups, they used that law, you know, just to provoke the Dutch government and the European Union, this team, you know, of the treaty. And so we went through a misery of a referendum vote, and it was a protest vote against something nobody knew exactly what about, but in the end, you know, it was a vote no against the treaty. And now, well, the Prime Minister, he did an effort, you know, to put an addendum to that treaty that did not change the treaty in content. And the House of Representatives was in favor of all this stuff, you know, and last week the Senate as well. So I hope we can conclude this miserable story, you know, and then look into the future again. And then, of course, the most important point is coming, what to do with that treaty. And that is quite a story, I can tell you.
You were talking about tomorrow's vote in the Parliament, in the Senate. Would you please argue what are the positive sides of this agreement between the European Union and Ukraine, and specifically, what are the advantages of this treaty for Europe, not only for Ukraine?
No, for Ukraine, well, that open borders to the West, of course, that's very important for you. The advantages for Europe, the European Union, and especially also for the Netherlands, you know, that is that you, in a geopolitical way, you know, you are a very important country, the place where you are situated. Of course, the opening to the Black Sea. But your country has a huge economical potential. Me, I'm coming from agriculture, and well, I had a company here growing potatoes. Well, a few years ago, I stopped with that, but I know what the potential is like of this country. And it is very good for European investors, you know, to have open borders to this country and take the opportunity to cooperate with you and bring Western money to this country. You know, there is too much money leaving your country. The other way around will be much better, in advantage of you too. And I think many investors, many countries, you know, are just waiting for the opportunities to settle here and do their utmost.
Thank you. For your
yeah, we are already the third investor in this country, so that already proves, you know, how important it is. Coming from my background, I told it this week already more times. The Netherlands is a small country, but on agriculture we are a world power, the second exporter in agricultural products worldwide. You know, we are very high developed in technology, in IT, in agriculture, in processing and that stuff. And we know how to trade all over the world. And the potential in agriculture in Ukraine is tremendous. You know, and when that border is open, you know, and you start to invest here in modernization of your agriculture, and it's always modernization is cooperation as well. I think the twinning of Dutch companies, you know, and Ukrainian companies is very promising, you know. So the two countries, the small Netherlands, but big in agriculture, and your big country and still not big enough in agriculture, you know, when we cooperate together, it will have a big future.
And speaking about populism, you worked a lot on this topic as philosopher, as a writer as well. Yeah. Would you please explain to us this phenomena and why populists are so powerful in Europe?
Yes, well, that is a theme, you know. I wrote in a few books I wrote about populism. I'm now finishing a book specifically on populism, not only in the Netherlands, but also in the rest of Europe and especially the United States. You know that Mr. Donald Trump, he is an example of it. To explain it in a few words, that is not too easy. Why they are powerful, it is not only, you know, that they found their political parties and as a party take over power. It's only in the United States Donald Trump took over power. But first, the Republicans themselves, they destroyed their institution, you know, their Republican Party as a structure, as an organization. It was a little bit bullshit, you know, what remained of that party, you know, fighting against each other. And so they created the black hole, and out of that black hole, Donald Trump could get in and is taking over power. In the Netherlands, as in France, as it will be in Germany, you know, the populists as a party were beaten. But their danger is not that they as persons or a political party take over power, but that they infect other parties to behave populists as well. And that you can see in the Netherlands, you know, that even my liberal party with a long history, you know, of civil rights and constitutional state and so on, is trying to get votes by behaving a little bit populist as well. And that is the danger of populism, that it is spreading not only them as a power, but they are infecting others. And so populism will be a normality. And to say something, then I go a little bit in depth, you know, populism comes from populus, and that is a Latin word, and that means people. And populism, the people, you know, that feel attracted to populism, they say, we are the people. And the people, that is a unity. And they feel home in that unity. But it is a unity as a mass being. So they are a little bit anonymous, all these people, but they say, well, okay, you know, we are anonymous, but so the people, that is we, you know, and then they feel better. But keep in mind, when you say we are the people, then there is always a them, a they, that is not the people, like the elite, or foreigners, or left-wing people, or ethnical minorities, or what more, you know. So it's always we against them. Populus, that is the Latin, means people. There is another word that is pointing a little bit to the same, and that is demos, and coming from the Greek. The Greek did not have the idea of a people as a unity. They always spoke about a population in multiple, a pluriform society with different groups. And for them, democracy, when it arose, democracy was the art, you know, of bringing these groups together somehow. And so the demos said there is a pluriform, a pluralistic society, and how to bring them together. And not it is not an incident, you know, that we use the word democracy as the same idea to express the same idea as the ancient Greeks, you know, that we accept society to be plural, many groups, and we have democracy to bring those groups together. And what populism is doing, that is replacing that idea of a pluralist society by that one homogeneous people and separated from them. And so, for instance, in the Netherlands, you know, we are blaming the people, the immigrants from Morocco or from Turkey or from God knows where from, you know, to say they are them, you know, but we don't trust them, they shouldn't be here, you know, they have to leave. And this has a history, you know, to separate the minorities from the people. You had it in communism, you know, the kulaks, that were not the people. You know, the Jews, they were not the people. And you know, in Hitler time you had the same, and now it's coming back, you know. We against them. And that is very dangerous because this is destroying the pluralist, the plural society. And we need that.
Thank you very much. Maybe a last question from me, and then I'll give the possibility for other journalists to ask you their questions. You're already talking as a philosopher. You wrote a lot about Nietzsche and about his notion of resentment and this notion, this sentiment explaining the rise of populism. Would you please briefly explain what you meant?
Yeah, it's another theme that I could use for a lecture of 2 or 3 hours to explain all the details. It has something to do, resentment, with populism. Resentment means, you know, that you don't feel good enough. You don't feel happy. You feel a little bit hurt. You have the idea that something is going wrong. And then you don't ask yourself the question, how come I feel a little bit wrong? No, the first question you raise is, who did it? Who could I blame that I feel wrong? Who is guilty of that? Something happened, it is a deed. It is done by somebody. It is done by some group. And this has a history, you know. Nietzsche, he lived, well, let's say 1.5 centuries ago. And already in that time, you know, at the end of the 19th century, he could feel that something was going on in Europe that could grow out very dangerous, you know, that complete groups of people would say something is done to us, you know, and we have to blame somebody. And here you see the same of we against them. Who did it? Well, of course, the Jews did it, you know, the kulaks, they did it. And that spirit of resentment will say, you know, that as you blame somebody, somebody should be punished. They did it. Well, normally you bring people to court and say, what did they do, you know, and then the deed is a matter, you know, for the judge, you know, to judge about. And no, the person is in the center. And even when you have not done anything, as you are that person, you are blamed as being that person, and something should happen to you. You should be punished or thrown out or whatever. And so resentment, that is that bad feeling you have, and that is always transmitted into who did it. Who should be blamed for that, you know, and who could be punished for it. In the hope that after punishment you feel better, which is of course not the case.
Thank you very much, Mr. Schaap. Maybe our colleagues have questions. Please wait until the microphone is there and then ask your question.
And please introduce yourself.
Mikola Siruk from Daily Deny, The Day. May you say, do you see that current government, I mean leaders in Europe, are trying to deal and with resentment and with populism to lead in right way, not to do as some Trump doing or other populists? Do you see that?
Oh, yes. Well, it's spreading, you know, that idea there is a we against them, against somebody, you know, and it's not only separating groups in society against each other, but also blaming. And in the Dutch elections we had, half a year ago, there you could see that even the civic political parties, like the Liberals and the Christian Democrats, you know, they wanted to attract a little bit the majority of the population, you know, to say, of course, we also want, you know, us to be Dutch, you know, and respect our tradition, and so on. And all the people that do not respect our tradition, get away. And that is dangerous, you know, when that idea is spreading. No, when you don't accept the tradition, you could better start a discussion, you know, what is wrong with our tradition? How could we improve it? How could we come together again? But no, not that, you know, it's ending up in a negative way and say, get out. And it was sad, you know, and well, look back in history, what could result out of that? The same Donald Trump, you know, when he was in the election, he immediately started to blame the Mexicans. And why? Well, they are criminals, you know, and there is no woman that can walk in the street anymore. When you go to the statistics, you could discover that the Mexicans are less criminal than the normal Americans, his people, you know, the we. And then they just say, you know, oh, we don't trust the facts, you know, we have better facts. So it's not even possible anymore to discuss because you don't rely on facts anymore. You just rely on opinions, on prejudice. That is so dangerous. And you can see in the United States that the population now is split. It was always a heterogeneous, well, all immigrants, everybody there is an immigrant, you know. And they always found ways to come together. And now the society is split. And that is dangerous. It could happen in France, you know, when the populist party, Marie Le Pen, will grow so big, you know, that the society is split in two. Well, maybe the new leader can bring the people together again, but it is dangerous, you know. It can end up in civil war. Maybe not a hot war, but you also can, that's an expression I used in my last book, you know, you can also have a cold civil war. You know, of course you don't murder each other, but you work up to splitting the society in different groups that don't communicate anymore and hate each other or blame each other or things like that.
So you do not see it might be dealing with populists? Don't you see that Germany and other European leaders do not are trying to deal with populism?
So Germany is an example of how it could be done better. They have, of course, a ridiculous history, but they learned from their history. And I think Germany is a very stable country, and thank God for that, because it's the biggest country, the leading country, etc., etc. They have a leader, you know, that does not blame anybody. And, well, hopefully, you know, France, the new leader, Macron, he has a little bit the same attitude, and when these two find each other and make that ex-Germany, France again strong, and then of course not only strong as powers, but strong as let's say a democratic culture and a culture of unifying Europe, well, that will be hopeful for the future to come.
Bohdana Kostyuk, Radio Free Europe, Radio Liberty. As you know, there are a lot of populists in Ukrainian political system as well.
Yeah, yeah.
What's your opinion, what we journalists and what civil society are able to do to stop them? Not to stop, but to maybe minimize their influence on people.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You know, it's a little bit difficult to come from another country and show up here and then tell you what to do, you know, that I'm not so in favor of that, but I look, but what you should do, look what's happening now in America. The democratic institutions, the constitutional institutions, you know, parliament, journalists, court, etc., etc., you know, they see the danger of Trump and his populism and they fight back. But they don't fight back in a way populism likes it. When Trump came up, all the newspapers and broadcast stations, they did the wrong thing. They said, wow, this is news, you know. So big headlines, you know, Trump, all the stupidities he did, you know, were brought in the newspapers, you know, so they could sell their papers. And that was very bad. What they are doing now, and I think that is something to keep in mind, they bring facts. They show the society, they show the population, listen, this and that is going on. They always bend it back to facts, not to opinions. Of course, you may have your opinion, but an opinion without a fact, without a fundament, is dangerous because it's loose. It could be anything. So I think, you know, US, well, the newspapers and television, radio and what more, always try to discover what's going on, what is the facts. So when populists are crying, you know, it's all criminality, they say, what criminality? And here is the statistics, and these statistics are reliable. So tell us, you know, what's wrong? Always keep in mind, you know, you have to spread opinion, okay, that, but keep in mind, you know, there is facts, and go back to the facts. I think that is the first thing you have to do. And the second point is, and that is a principle of morality as well, when you are not politicized as the media here, you know, try to cover all the society. And even when there are minorities, you know, that don't feel well, take them serious, because they maybe they express the problem in a wrong way, but they have a problem. Yeah, and try to find out what's the problem. Do they feel threatened or so, or unhappy, or and take that seriously, also in a factual way. So don't say you are a bunch of crooks, you know, and then you are doing the same, you know, it's we them. No. Try to bring them in that, well, wide definition of demos, you know, of the population as well. A few things. Could be more, but.
Thank you very much, Mr. Schaap. Maybe some other questions from our colleagues? We don't have a question. Yes, you have? Just no. Wait a minute for a microphone.
Make discussion. Blame me.
No, I do not blame. Do you see that politician or political elite in your country has taken lesson from this miserable law on referendum? Will it be changed or
the
not?
The miserable war where?
Miserable law on referendum.
The pop, no. Yeah. You know, a referendum is bringing back complicated questions into the most simple thing you can invent, you know, yes or no, black or white. All the world is a mix of all colors, and they only bring it back to. For instance, when 60% of the people who came to vote on the Ukraine treaty, then the statement they had to respond on was, do you accept this agreement with Ukraine? And then 60% said no. The interpretation was they are against the treaty. They don't want this treaty. They don't want this agreement. They don't want any agreement with Ukraine at all. But you could also interpret the vote, the result, that people said, this is an agreement, but it doesn't go far enough. We want an agreement that Ukraine will be a partner of the European Union. We want more. Nobody can interpret it. So all the participants, you know, in a discussion, you know, they all take the result and say, hey, this is my interpretation and that is the best one. It does not work. A referenda never do it. Yeah, also in this country, a referendum makes complicated things, you know, simple. But when they are complicated, you can't make them simple. And that is in a representative democracy, you go into the parliament when you have, of course, a well-functioning parliament, that is a presupposition. But then all the ideas, you know, all the opinions, all the standpoints, all the interests, you know, they come together and they are in debate and they debate and go on and go on. It could be for days or maybe weeks. And then in the end, they come to some compromise in which everybody can discover himself a little bit. That is the best, you know, somewhere in the middle. And you say, okay, this will be the decision until we make a better one. But now we are out. So you take the complete diversity in what's at stake, you know, you take it seriously. And in a referendum, it's yes or no. And then you ask, did we learn something from it? Of course, the populists know, they only want a referenda because they know all the vote of people will be a protest vote, so that's enough. But the civic parties, like the Liberals, the Social Democrats, the Christian Democrats, their general opinion is now this is a ridiculous law, and in fact we should skip it.
Thank you very much, Mr. Schaap. Unfortunately, we don't have time for another question, so we'll follow with an interview. Шановні журналісти, наступний брифінг буквально за одну хвилину. Підприємці представлять Україну в Лондоні під час Всесвітнього кубку «Енактус».